In 1967, a rather shocking plane crash occurred in the United Kingdom that claimed the lives of 72 people. The term fuel starvation is attached to this accident. It's a term that is pretty self-explanatory, and fuel starvation could occur for many reasons, and it's not always as straightforward as a plane simply running out of fuel, though that has happened. It can also refer to a scenario where the engines are not receiving the fuel they demand. The case of British Midland Flight 542, the Stockport Air Disaster, I would say falls into that subcategory. This was a case of fuel being present on the plane, yet engine flameout still occurred. So what happened here? Well, to unpack this, we need to go back to 1967. It was the very early hours of Sunday, June 4th, 1967. A group of holidaymakers were in the airport on the Spanish Balearic island of Palma de Mallorca. A plane had been chartered to return them home to England following their vacation on the popular island. British Midland Airways had been contracted for this flight, and the plane they employed was a Canadair North Star Argonaut. This is certainly an interesting plane. It was developed from the Douglas DC-4, an aircraft that dates back to the early 1940s. Canadian manufacturer Canadair took on the manufacturing of the plane and gave it a bit of an upgrade by replacing the engines and swapping out parts of the DC-4 with that from the newer DC-6. Canadair called this the North Star. The North Star was just one of multiple revamps the DC-4 would receive, perhaps the most extravagant of which being the ATL Carver, which we've already talked about before. Most North Stars flew for Canadian Airlines and the Canadian Air Force. A number of them, though, were picked up by the British state-owned air carrier of the day, BOAC. BOAC rebranded these planes again and called them Argonauts. They flew the Argonauts between the years of 1949 and 1960. Once retired, British Midland acquired 5 Argonauts in 1961. Which brings us back to the morning of June 4th, 1967, and the accident plane registered as Golf Alpha Lima Hotel Golf, which had been flying for British Midland since then. At 6:06 in the morning, flying as British Midland Flight 542, this Argonaut carrying 84 passengers and crew took to the skies in Palma. There were 3 people that morning on the flight deck of the aircraft. 41-year-old Captain Harry Marlowe was commanding the flight. Having previously served in the Royal Air Force, he was certainly an experienced pilot with over 10,000 flight hours logged, and had actually been acquainted with the DC-4 and its derivatives since the 1950s. His tenure as an airplane captain, though, had been a bit turbulent. He was actually demoted down to a first officer position in 1964 following a heavy landing, according to the accident report. His captain status, though, was reportedly reinstated in 1965. He was joined on the flight deck that morning by the much younger first officer, 21-year-old Christopher Pollard. Originally from Cornwall, he'd been flying commercially for just a few years by that point, with just over 1,000 flight hours to his name. Literally, he logged 1,001 to be exact. He achieved his 1,000th flight hour, the journey out to Palma, earlier that morning. The third person on the flight deck was a ground engineer, a man by the name of Gerald Lloyd. Curiously, we couldn't actually find an age for this individual. But the accident report does indicate that Mr. Lloyd had no responsibilities when it came to the flying or operating of the plane, but would step in if asked to do so by the captain or first officer. His main role was to fulfill duties related to maintenance of the aircraft whilst on the ground. Flight 542 continued in its flight that morning, heading north back to the United Kingdom. Their destination? Manchester in northern England. For this leg, First Officer Christopher Pollard was handling the flight controls. Captain Marlowe was handling radio communications. The flight was pretty much uneventful as the sun rose into the sky at dawn. These days, modern planes can make this journey in just 2 hours. In a much slower prop liner from the 1940s, the same journey took nearly twice as long. We should now for a moment turn our attention away from the plane and take a bit of a look at their destination, Manchester. Manchester Airport at the time was a lot smaller than it is today. In 1967, it was actually known as Ringway Airport and had just one runway. The runway runs from northeast to southwest. Due to prevailing winds in the region, it is often the case that planes land in from the north onto runway 24. This involves flying overhead many populated areas that surround the city of Manchester, and the residents underneath the flight path have certainly been no stranger to tragedy. In 1957, a Vickers Viscount crashed into the homes of residents on Shadow Moss Road nearby to the airport, resulting in 22 fatalities. Backing up further, we'll find the town of Stockport. Stockport town centre lies almost directly underneath the flight path to the airport, even in 1967. Flight 542, the Axton plane, would need to be lined up with the runway extended centreline overhead Stockport. At 9:56 local time, approaching Manchester from the south, the flight intercepted a waypoint over the town of Congleton. From here, the plane would now be directed north of the airport, make a left turn, and intercept the ILS. The flight was cleared to descend down to 3,500 feet. Up till this point, the flight had been uneventful. At 10:01, as the pilots were lining the aircraft up with the runway at Manchester over Stockport, the two right side engines failed. They cut out. So what exactly happened here? Well, the simple answer to that is that the two right side engines were starved of fuel. It is a bit more complicated than that though. The plane had the fuel, so why wasn't it getting to the engines? To understand this, we need to familiarize ourselves with this aircraft's fuel storage system. The Argonaut had a total of 8 fuel tanks. 4 pairs of 2 consisting of a main and auxiliary fuel tank, and each pair of tanks feeds one of the 4 engines. Now airplanes tend to have something called a crossfeed. Crossfeed is a method whereby a pilot may want to feed an engine fuel from another tank. For example, fuel can be brought over from tanks within an opposing wing if necessary. There are a number of reasons as to why a pilot might want to do this. It could be for balance distribution reasons. Or maybe in an emergency situation involving a fuel leak, fuel can be fed to a different engine as to not waste it. This was not the case here. The problem that came about on the British Midland flight was actually linked to something that pilots of the Argonaut and North Star had actually picked up on over the years. Since Canadair launched the plane all the way back in 1946, pilots and engineers on the aircraft noticed that certain instruments, gauges, and switches were not only difficult to read, but some were also placed in inconvenient areas of the cockpit. This included the crossfeed system. It was actually concealed almost entirely by the throttle controls when a pilot is strapped into their seat, so they couldn't really see it. Pilots found it was often unclear which tanks had been selected for their crossfeeding processes. So I think you'll probably agree with me when I say that this design is objectively terrible. This is important because it was known that the crossfeed system on this plane could be inadvertently selected into a false setting and begin a cross-ship crossfeed, that being where the fuel tanks in one wing are being transported to the engines on the other side. That's pretty much what happened here, and given the unclear nature of its design, the pilots weren't aware of this. The issue was reported by pilots both on the Argonauts in the United Kingdom and the North Stars in Canada. However, none of the small handful of airlines that flew the planes forwarded these concerns from the pilots to the manufacturer. Without this feedback, obviously they weren't aware that changes should be made. Pilots continued to fly the plane with a crossfeed system that was unintuitive and prone to failure. This key design flaw in the fuel system compounded against pilot fatigue. The pilots were approaching the end of what was, at that point, a 13-hour shift. Investigators found further evidence of fatigue from the captain's radio communications, as multiple errors were noted in his transmissions. Additionally, the failure on board the British Midland plane came at a very interesting point. The pilots had begun the approach checklist, which called for a check of the fuel systems. This included a step for the crossfeed. It should be in the off position. Investigators believed that the failure of the engines aligned with when the pilots performed this step. A pilot may well have handled the crossfeed valve controls, accidentally causing it to crack into an on position. This was why the failure occurred during approach and not in the preceding hours. So, to summarize, what this effectively led to was a configuration of the fuel system where the right side engines were inadvertently starved of fuel because the crossfeed was hard to read, operate, and the pilots were tired and evidently didn't realize what had happened. At that moment of failure, overhead Stockport at 10:01 in the morning on June 4th, 1967, the number 3 and 4 engines on the right side flamed out. First, the number 4 engine, followed quickly by number 3. At this point, they had been trying to line the plane up with the runway, but following the failure, they began experiencing flight control difficulties that pulled them off of their approach path. The pilots may not have been aware of the double failure, as only the number 4 engine propellers were placed into the feathered position. The failed number 3 propellers continued to windmill, that is to say, spinning in the wind. Captain Marlowe took over from First Officer Pollard when the problem was first noticed and immediately experienced difficulty in controlling the plane. As all the thrust was now being generated from the left side, this gave the plane a natural tendency to roll right. At just 6 miles from the runway, the plane broke off the approach path even though the airspeed of the plane was believed to have been under 120 knots. What followed was a large right turn. This was against the controller's instruction to turn left, as was normal in a missed approach scenario. However, Captain Marlowe had already begun the right turn, likely induced further by the natural roll brought on by the engine failure. The instruction was given to continue a right turn, first through north, then northeast. By this point, the airspeed had decreased further, and it was becoming exceedingly difficult for the pilots to maintain their altitude. The plane began to descend. With just half the engine power and a full plane, the pilots would attempt to extend their glide path as long as possible, and began to reattempt another landing at Manchester. This brought the plane back towards Stockport. 10:07, airspeed decreased further to below 100 knots. The altitude situation had grown to a critical level. They were just a few hundred feet from the buildings below, and they were nowhere near the airport. Flight 542 was gliding straight towards the Stockport town centre. As the situation had grown desperate, the captain began looking out for anywhere he could put the plane down. In this urban landscape, there existed just one tiny sector of land in the centre of Stockport that was open. It's an area called Hope's Car. The small area of grassland here was nowhere near big enough to land a plane, but it was their only option at this point. Bystanders on the ground observed the plane making a large left turn in the final seconds of the flight. This suggested to investigators that the pilots still had some semblance of control. As the final action before the crash, Captain Marlowe shut down the remaining engines. At just after 10:09, the plane impacted the ground with a slight right bank. The left wing clipped an apartment building in the process. Captain Marlowe had managed to crash his plane in a tiny space surrounded by apartment buildings, hotels, and retail space. Because of the captain's quick thinking, there were no fatalities on the ground. Dozens, however, perished on board the plane. Of the 84 occupants on the flight, 72 were now dead. This left 12 survivors. Among them was Captain Harry Marlowe. However, in addition to the injuries he sustained in the crash, he also experienced amnesia and reportedly had trouble recalling the events of the flight. However, whilst in hospital, he was able to tell investigators that following the failure of the two right side engines, he found it difficult to control the plane. It was concluded by investigators that, given the circumstances, there wasn't a whole lot the pilots could have done in that short space of time to get the plane to safety. An inquiry after the accident cleared Captain Marlowe of any blame in the crash. His injuries, however, killed his piloting career. He never flew again. Still, he lived out the rest of his life before his eventual passing in 2009. Investigators made just one recommendation in the aftermath, and that was to give a warning to operators of the North Star Argonauts and all other planes with similar valve components in the fuel system, to ensure that pilots fully know the status of their fuel configuration. Today, the Canadair North Star Argonaut is pretty much a curious footnote in aviation history. Though some DC-4s have survived to this current day, its derivatives have long since been retired. The Stockport Air Disaster is still remembered in the Manchester region. A memorial now stands at the scene of where disaster struck all those years ago. Hello everyone. thank you so much for watching. I believe it might be time for me to have a little bit of a chat with my viewers here about something. A couple of weeks back, I mentioned at the end of the lot video that I was actually thinking of changing the upload schedule to one that would mean I would release a video as and when they are completed, instead of every Saturday. I have decided that I will try this out, starting from the beginning of June. This is primarily because I would like to make bigger and better videos for you all. I would like 30, 35, or even 40 minute videos to be the regular, not including research of these videos, which is almost always ongoing in the background. The production of one video with just me doing all of the work, I was able to spread over the course of 1 week for the last 2.5 years. Because of that, I have never missed a weekend upload in that time. It's a level of consistency I have been very happy with and sad to see potentially go. However, as the average length of a video has increased, it's become a lot more difficult to do, and I'm just going to need more time if I want to make those sorts of videos. It will also allow me the time to continue background work on other videos. I still have a railway video to complete, and I'd also like to make a chronological breakdown of 9/11, for example. So, we'll try it, but it could be that next week might actually be the end of regular Saturday uploads. I feel it was important to share this update with you, as I know a number of you from the comments I receive always seem to look forward to my Saturday videos. So thank you all so much for sticking around with me all this time. Anyway, with that update noted, I would like to take a moment to thank my amazing patrons over on Patreon for their amazing support to the channel. Their names are scrolling on the screen right now, so if you do see your name here, a massive thanks to you. Shout out this week to Band-Aid Brigade, who pledged at the highest tier this week. Thank you so very much. Truly, truly a legend. If you yourself would like to support the channel further, you can join the Disaster Breakdown Patreon from just £1 per month, and the link to that will be in the pinned comment below. All patrons get early access to all new content 2 days before it goes out publicly on YouTube, and that will stay the same in this new change to the uploads. Anyway, I'm going to sign off on this video now. Thank you so much for watching, and I shall see you next week. Goodbye!